sì, sta per partire.
Tra poco lo saremo.
Vabbè, abbiamo capito.
Non dai il via libera adesso, sono qui.
Dai, abbiamo capito. Non vuoi che queste cose
partito,
Marco, va bene. Mi sembra anche giusto.
Partiti.
Partiti. Ok. E allora, buonasera. Possiamo aprire la seduta di laurea in Ingegneria e Scienze Informatiche con il candidato Paolo Zanghi. La presentazione del lavoro di tesi avverrà in lingua inglese, così come la discussione con la commissione. Quindi, ok, se il relatore, la professoressa Xibilia, vuole introdurre il lavoro e poi andiamo direttamente con la presentazione.
Sì, grazie. The thesis proposed by Paolo deals with a very relevant problem in process control, that is the identification of nonlinear dynamical model for systems, industrial systems, and in particular he dealt with a system of the refinery of Priolo, which is a sulfur recovery unit, which became a benchmark by many researchers in the field. He designed and compared a number of different machine learning approaches, some are recent, some are more classical, but and comparing it also by the point of view of performance and numerical complexity. And finally, he applied a transfer learning approach that is very interesting in this field because it allows to save a lot of time in designing a model for these systems. Puoi andare, Paolo.
Ringrazio la professoressa per la presentazione. Ok, vedete tutti, no?
Sì, grazie.
Ok. The title of this thesis is Recurrent Neural Networks for the Identification of Nonlinear Dynamic System. In the first part of this presentation is quickly described the case study, a sulfur recovery unit. After that is show all the way used to design all the network inside the thesis. A first comparison is done on the best performance reached with each network. A statistical analysis based on 100 network with the same structure but different initial condition, the transfer learning procedure, and finally the conclusions. So the object of the thesis is to design a nonlinear dynamic model for an industrial process. This industrial process is the sulfur recovery unit that is present in each refinery. And to solve this task are designed several neural networks as feed-forward neural networks with tapped delay lines, recurrent neural network, long short-term memory network, Eschenstein network, Eschenstein network with intrinsic plasticity, and deep Eschenstein network. So the sulfur recovery unit refers to the conversion of gases coming out from other parts of the plant to liquid sulfur. An SRU is mainly composed by four different units called sulfur lines, which there is an example of one of this unit in the picture, and the final part of the process, the unconverted gas, form the tail gas that is always measured to have a control on the conversion process. The first step is to burn the HOS to divide it in SO2 and HOS in a ratio 1:2. After that, there is the catalytic section where these gases are used to form the liquid sulfur. In this kind of process, between the 95% and 98% of the elemental sulfur is recovered. In this slide, it's possible to see an example of the dataset used to solve the ESRU task inside this thesis. This is composed by 5 input and 2 output. In this presentation, for taming problem, will be shown just the analysis and the performance for the first output, the sulfur dioxide, but in the thesis, of course, contains results for both the output. So the nature of this process required the use of a dynamical model as an ARCS model. A first approach is done with an N-FIR model based on a feed-forward neural network, such a multilayer perceptron. Here it's possible to see the delayed input matrix used for the MLP and all the parameters used to find the best performance with the MLP. These parameters are the number of hidden layers and the number of neurons inside of each layer. In these two graphs, it shows how the train error on the left and the test error on the right change in function of the number of nodes. In the second graph, it's possible to see how the increasing of the number of nodes make increase also the test error. Here, there are the obtained results and the best structure for the first output. After that, are investigated the recurrent neural network, starting from a classical recurrent neural network. This kind of network have two different kinds of recursion: the output recursion, that is the green line in the figure, and the red line in the figure is for the internal recursion. In the table are shown all the parameters used to find the best performance with the RNN, that are number of hidden layer, number of neurons inside of each layer, and the number of the internal and the output recurrency, while in the graphs it shows the error history of the process without any recurrence, with just the internal recurrency, with only the output recurrency, and with both the internal and output recurrency. In this case, I'll always reach the best performance. The RNN are trained with two different methods, the Levenberg Markov method, LM, and the Brody-Fletcher Goldfarb-Shannon method, the BFGS, and here are showing the final results for both, always for the first output. The RNN shows very good performance, but also a lot of training problem, as the training time that is very long, and also training problem called vanishing and exploding gradient. In order to solve these problems, we study another kind of recurrent neural networks called long short-term memory network. This particular network succeeds in solving the RNN problem thanks to its particular structure, shown in the picture, that is based on a cell memory that interacts with three different gates, the forget gate, the input gate, and the output gate, that decide which information to maintain or forget about the process. In the table, there are all the parameters used to design the LSTM, number of neurons and number of layers, the learning iteration and the initial scaling of the input and the forget gate, while in the box plot is show how the test error change in function of the number of layers and the number of neurons. Here, there is the same analysis for the forget scaling, the input scaling, and the learning iteration. In the last picture, it's important to see how to obtain good performance is required a wide number of learning iteration. Here, there are the final results obtained with the LSTM with the best structure obtained. The LSTM solves the training problem of the RNN, but the training time are still very long. So in order to improve this aspect, we study another kind of recurrent neural networks based on the reservoir computing paradigm. These kind of networks are composed by a wide reservoir that is recurrent and stay untrained for all the process, and a set of connections that link the reservoir neurons with the output neurons that is linearly trained. The network study with this kind of paradigm is the Echo State Network that have this capacity to maintain an echo, a memory, in its internal state. Here is possible to see the update equation of this network, where x con n is the current state and x tilde is its update. W in is the weighted matrix of the input, the blue line in the graph, while W is the weighted matrix of the reservoir, the green line in the graph. Alpha is a constant between 0 and 1 called linking rate. Here there is the equation of the linear readout, the yellow line in the graph, that depends from the current input and the current state, and it also possible to add feedback connection that change the update equation in this way with the last sample of the output. In this slide, there are the best, the more important parameters to design an ESN. There are the reservoir size, so the number of neurons inside the reservoir with their connection that have to be generated random and sparse. The scaling of the input, there is another part that stay untrained for all the process. And the most important parameters, that is the spectral radius, that is defined as the maximum edge value of the reservoir weighted matrix, and from this parameter depends the echo state property, the capacity of the network to maintain the memory. Here we have all the parameters used to design the ESN, while in the box plot is show how the test error change in function of the spectral radius, as is in this case for both the output. As is possible to see, the best performance are always reached for high value of the spectral radius. Here there is the same analysis for the feedback value, the input scaling value and the number of neurons inside the reservoir. As is possible to see, the best performance are always reached for a feedback value equals to zero and low value of the input scaling. Here, the best structure obtained with the ESN and the best performance achieved with the ESN for the first output. Finally, two methods to the reservoir optimization are used, the ESN-IP, the ESN with intrinsic plasticity, and the deep ESN. So the aim of the ESN-IP is to maximize the transferred information by an unsupervised rule that folds the output distribution of the reservoir to converge to a desired Gaussian distribution. This is done with two parameters, the gain A and the bias B, that are created iteratively with this update rule. In these formulas, mu and sigma are the mean and the standard deviation of the desired Gaussian distribution, while eta is the learning gate of the process. Finally, there is the update equation of the normal ESN with the add of IP parameters when W hat and W in hat are the reservoir weighted matrix and the reservoir input matrix with the IP parameters. In this feature is shown in the first one how the test error decreases at each step of the IP parameters, while in the second graph there is the difference between 100 different network trained with the blue line and without the red line the IP parameters. Here it's possible to see all the parameters used to design the ESN IP that actually are the same of the ESN with the add of eta, mu and sigma, while in this graph is show how the test error change in function of the sigma on the y-axis, the mu on the x-axis and the eta, the color bar on the right. Finally, the best structure found and the best performance achieved for the ESN IP. The last network used is a deep ESN. It is composed by an hierarchic structure where the output of each reservoir acts as an input for the next reservoir. The internal state in this case is a set of internal states, as is possible to see in the slide, and the linear readout depends just from this set of internal states and not also from the current input as for the normal ESN. In the table on the left, there are like always the parameters used to design the DPSN, the number of neurons and the number of lanes and the spectral radius. That is always the same for all the reservoirs that composing the network. And in the figure, it's possible to see how the test error change in function of the number of neurons and the number of layers. As is possible to see, the best performance are always reached for low value of neurons and layers. Here, for the last time, there are the final results obtained and the final structure obtained for the first output. A first comparison is done on the test error for all the networks. In these graphs are present both the first, the blue bar, and the second, the orange bar, outputs. As is possible to see, the best performance are always reached with the RNNs, while for the first output, very good performance are also reached with the ESN IP. From a correlation coefficient point of view, always from the test set, it's possible to see the same performance with the RNN LM that reach the best performance for the first output and the RNN BFGS for the second one. Okay, this part of the thesis is a statistical analysis based on 100 different networks per time, always with the same structure, there is the same found in the network design, but different initial condition. In the table on the left, it's possible to see the mean training time per run for each type of network studied. The blue value is the lower training time found, while the red value is the higher. The bubble chart on the right shows this kind of analysis for the test error and the correlation coefficient for the first output. Taking as an example the graph, the first graph, the test error graph, on the y-axis we have the test error, on the x-axis the learning time in a logarithmic scale, while the size of the bubble is the standard deviation of the error. This kind of analysis underscores how the RNNs have very long training time compared with all the other networks used inside the thesis, and how their final results are subjected to great fluctuation in their results. The SNIP with this kind of analysis show best performance both in terms of mean and standard deviation of the error, theta for the learning time. Finally, the transfer learning procedure that consists of seeking the best performance on a given problem to after applied on a related issue. In this case, all the structure found on the first dataset are retrained on a related physical process. In this slide, it's possible to see the difference between the two datasets used, the first dataset on the left and the new dataset on the right. The transfer learning procedure is done in two different steps. In the first step, the training is done with the same best performance or the same best structures found on the first dataset, so in the network design part. And the second step, where the training is done in around 20% of the total parameter used. Here it's possible to see the final results of the transfer learning after the first step. The blue bar represents the test error, while the orange bar the correlation coefficient. And it's possible to see how all the networks increase their performance, with the exception of DPSN. Also in this case, the RNN LM reached the best absolute performance. Here, there is how this error change after the second step. The blue bar represents the error after the second step, while the orange bar represents how the error decreases between the two steps. Again, the RNN LM reached the best results, but is the only one that not decrease its error between the two steps. Okay, this new dataset is often used in literature as a benchmark, so this allows us to a comparison between the transferred transfer data obtained in this work with what found in literature. As in this case, RNN shows the best performance among all the methods based on a single model, but is still not able to reach the same performance of method based on more complex structure. So, in conclusion, is done the identification of nonlinear dynamic system by recurrent neural network. The first comparison between the best structure on the best performance shows how RNN reached the best absolute performance. But from a statistical analysis point of view, the SNIP give more consistent results, also requiring the lower computational effort. Finally, is done the transfer learning procedure that demonstrates how the search for a suitable hyperparameters is no more required to identify a similar process. With this data obtained with the transfer learning, is done the comparison with the state of art, where RNN LM shows better performance with respect of all the methods proposed in literature based on a single model. Thank you. Ho finito.
Marco, il microfono deve attivare.
Yes, yeah, sorry. Thank you for your presentation.
Thanks.
Now the committee has the opportunity to ask for a question to candidate. So
okay.
If someone. Any question? I can start with one maybe trivial question. So when you one of the first graphs you showed about the learning iteration.
The transfer learning.
No, before. One of the first. I remember there was a graph with learning iteration as title.
Learning iteration. This one, maybe.
Yeah.
Okay.
This one. You better explain the meaning of this graph. I can see on the y axis the number 1.1, 1.2, which is the meaning
and the definition. Okay,
parameters are shown.
On the y-axis, there is the test error. This graph represents how the test error change in function of the recurrence scale. That is the initial scaling of the forget gate. The input scale, that is the initial scaling of the input gate and the learning iteration. So this is actual for all the try, the test error. In this box plot, there are all the try with for the test error with these parameters.
Okay, and the graph as present the confidence interval. So in the graph, there are lines and set of values, right? And they represent a confidence interval, right?
Sorry, okay. I didn't understand. The voice is up and down.
Sorry, maybe the connection is not good. Anyway, okay, I try to repeat.
Okay.
To better understand how the data are organized in the graph, right?
Sure.
I suppose you are representing the confidence interval. Is it correct?
Yes. Okay. Actually, this, for example, in the first graph or the last graph. Okay. In each of these graphs, each box plot represents all the results of all the network tried with that value of the parameters. For example, for the learning rate, the first box plot represents all the test error of all the networks trained with from 50 to 150 learning iteration. While, for example, in the second box, there are the whole the test error obtained on all the networks with learning iteration that go from 150 to 250.
Yeah, and in the y-interval in the y-axis is the confidence interval?
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Inside the box.
Yeah.
The red cross are outliers, while the dotted line are the best results and the worst results that are far from the average value, that is the red line.
But that polygon, what represents?
What does it mean?
You mean the shape of the box?
The polygon that you see here.
No, it's actually don't represent anything. It's not important. It could be a normal box plot. Okay.
So it's just fun
tutorial.
Something.
It's an idea of Professor Sibila.
No, it's an idea of the guy who implemented the toolbox.
Because the shape changes for if you look at the first graph on the left, on the right there are differences on the shapes. So I suppose that
I
some meaning is
the relation of the asymmetry of the Gaussian.
Okay.
All approved by the supervisor, by the way.
So practically the red cross are outliers, the horizontal lines represent the mean and max values, and in between the figure represent the division of percentiles. So we have the data distributed in four percentiles, and so the first blue line is the limit of the 25% of the data, the red line is the 50% and so on.
Okay. So, other questions? No question at all? Okay. If there are no other questions, I thanks again the candidate. And now we will meet. You're welcome. In the other rooms, right? in order to